Steve Harding joins me now. Steve's a professor of biochemistry at Nottingham University. He was born and bred in Wallasey, and he's written two books about the link between Wirral and Norway, the Vikings, and one with Magnus Magnusson as well, which comes out in a fortnight, and he's also involved with the BBC programme Blood of the Vikings, which is being screened later this year. How do you find the time to be a biochemist?
That's what the wife says, actually, Terry, thanks. It's strange, actually, because I've been trained as a scientist. I did my degree in physics, of all things. And the story is that when I was revising for my final examinations in physics, I was sitting in my college library, bored to death. I looked on the shelves, and there was this book, Scandinavian England, by F.T. Wainwright. So I took it off the shelf and opened it, and I was amazed. Nearly half the book was about the Wirral. And I thought, gosh, you know, I didn't know this.
Because you're a Wallasey lad born and bred, aren't you?
That's right, Wallasey born and bred, yeah. And, you know, at school we never heard anything about this sort of stuff. I knew a bit about Thor's stone at Thurstaston and about Thingwall, but and I thought, gosh, you know, if I don't know about this, then I presume the rest of the world doesn't know about this either. So I thought, you know, maybe we should be done about it. And that was 25 years ago.
And that's what got you into it, was it?
Well, I had this idea to write a book then. Hmm. And as always, ideas remain ideas until you do something about it.
So why did the Viking, why did they pick the Wirral then? Did they have a map and say, hey, that looks all right there?
Absolutely, yes.
Tucked away on the peninsula, we'll have a bit of that. Was it as simple as that, was it all?
It was not quite so simple as that, but they made the right choice, I must admit. I mean, it all started off back in the 10th century, and as always, you can blame it on a woman. There was this...
I'm glad you said that, not me.
This Viking king, Norwegian king, called Harald the Furher, Harald Haarfagre, in Norwegian. Mm. And then Norway was not one kingdom, but a lot of little kingdoms. And he fancied this this woman called Egida. And she said that she would only give her hand in marriage if he was able to unite the whole of Norway and show her that he was worthy of her. So what he did was he vowed to grow his hair and never to cut it until he actually united all of Norway, which took him a few years, so he got a bit of a scruffy scruffy so-and-so.
Hence the name, the fair hair.
Yeah, but when he actually united Norway, he gave the choice of all the northern kings to come in with him or to leave. And, you know, Norwegians are a stubborn bunch, and they actually chose to leave, most of them. And that gave the impetus for the Great Viking Age.
Mm. And I mean, when I think of Vikings, and I'm sure there's a lot of people like me, when you think of the Vikings, you think, oh, geez, frightening big 6 foot, 7 foot, 8 foot monsters who come and, you know, pillage and burn villages down. Were they like that? Were they a very peaceful, intelligent race of people, though, weren't they?
The archetypal picture of a Viking is somebody who's very violent and, you know, raping, pillaging, all this sort of stuff. And as seen in the Kirk Douglas film. But actually, they were more like, if I can use the analogy, Magnus Magnusson. You know, you can't think of him as being one
really?
Of those. Really? Yeah. And, of course, there were two types of Vikings. There were the Danes, who came in from the east and landed, you know, in Grimsby or around there and took control of the eastern half of England. They were the Norwegian Vikings, and what they did, they left Norway. They headed west over the top of Scotland, some carrying on to Iceland, even to the States, but lots of them actually came down the west coast of Scotland, settled in the Isle of Man, and a lot actually settled in Ireland, in Dublin. Dublin is an old Viking kingdom. And what happened was that either the population got too big in Dublin, or they lost a couple of crucial battles against the Irish, but they, again, had to leave Ireland. And I guess Ingemund, this leader of the Wirral Norwegians, was one of these people that had to leave Dublin. They came across in their Viking ships. They tried to settle in Anglesey, first of all, then lost another battle, this time against the Welsh.
They're not very good at fighting, these Vikings, are they? Irish, they've lost to the Welsh.
But again, these are the Magnus Magnusson sort, not the Kirk Douglas sort, I suppose. Actually, they were quite a violent bunch in some ways. They could certainly defend themselves. But they were given permission by the then Queen of England, who was the daughter of Alfred the Great, to land in or settle in lands near Chester. And it's all recorded in these ancient Irish annals of Ingimund leaving Ireland, trying to settle in Anglesey, and then coming to the Wirral. And they stayed. They liked the place, and they
stayed.
Well,
obviously, the people of the Wirral were very welcoming, Steve. They said, Viking, we don't mind. You come and stay here. That's no problem. Because they said they stayed and settled, and they gave a lot of their names to certain parts of the Wirral as well.
It became densely populated, and it became virtually a Viking state. With its own language, Old Norse, its border. Actually, it's quite ironic because the, you know, modern Wirral now, there's a lot of fuss about this division between North Wirral and South Wirral following the 1974 government reorganisation. But actually, this boundary between North Wirral and South Wirral follows very closely to the original boundary of the old Viking kingdom.
Ah.
And right in the middle of this Viking kingdom was a place called Thingwall.
Ah.
Now, Thingwall.
Yeah, now thinking of that now, that sounds very Viking, doesn't it? That does.
It is very Viking. Because in Iceland, there's a place called Thingvellir, which was the site of the Icelandic parliament. In the Isle of Man, you've got Tynwald, which again is still a sort of parliament to the Manx. And the name of the modern Norwegian parliament is the Storting. So Ting,
Storting.
Thing. Now, Stord means something else.
Ah.
I'll come to that in a minute. But the Thing, a Thing actually means an assembly or parliament. And the Warbit comes from fields. So Thingwall means assembly fields.
Ah.
So that's where Ingimund and his successors had his parliament. So it was a Viking state all those years ago. And so Old Norse was being spoken. And we believe it's being spoken well into the 13th, 14th century.
As late on as that?
We believe so, because in parish records, people's names have the, or some of them have the Icelandic ending. I don't know, have you got any kids yourself, Tony?
Yeah, I've got a little boy, yeah.
Yeah. Now, the tradition is we name our kids after our own surname.
Mm.
But the Icelanders don't do this. So if you've got a boy, yes?
Yeah, I've got a little boy.
And so his name would be
Callum.
Not Snell, but his name would be Callum Tony's son.
Ah, so it would be Callum Tonyson.
That's right.
It would be like that.
Yeah.
Oh, I see.
And if it was a daughter, it would be Tony's daughter. And there's records, parish records, of people with this ending up until the 15th century. So that means, you know, while England was getting on with its old merry ways, you know, Richard III was fighting Bosworth, Wars of the Roses and things, Henry V... The Wirral was carrying on its own sweet way, talking its own language, completely oblivious of what was going on elsewhere. And
this all happened because you sat down bored one day in the library and found a book on a shelf.
Well, it didn't happen because of that.
No, but your interest in the whole of this.
Absolutely.
Have you become obsessed with it, do you think, you know, or is it just a general interest? Or
One could say my wife thinks I'm obsessed.
Because we read about families who dress up as Vikings and spend lots of time in the garden. You're not one of these, are you, Steve?
Yeah, well, people knock these people. I'm not one of them. But I think they do a lot of good. And there's a community in the Wirral called the Wirral Skip Felag. And they go to great detail to reproduce the costume and the manner of these people.
The way it was back in those days.
Yes, yeah. So I've no objections to these people at all. I think they do a grand job. And, of course, in the Wirral, it's based on historical fact.
Tell me about your name then, Steve. Steve Harding.
Yeah.
What's your name? Because I believe that's right. You can translate that back to the Viking days.
Yeah, well, it's a bit unfortunate. I mean, Harding, of course, is a very common name in the UK now. But in modern Norwegian, Harding means tough guy, tough man, even skinhead. And it's used, actually, for someone who's a tough cross-country skier.
Mm.
And with my scientific work, I've got a lot of mates up in Trondheim in North Norway, and it was to their great frustration when they put me on a pair of skis, and I basically fell over, and they said, how can someone with the name of Harding, you know, not stand up on a pair of skis?
Not so tough now. Well, so we're going to take a little bit of music, and it is the theme from the Vikings, the Kirk Douglas one,
right?
Just to get us in the mood, and we'll talk maybe about some more local names on the Wirral that have got Viking connections, if we may.
Absolutely, yes.
Thank you. Now, that piece of music always reminds me, right at the end of Vikings, where you've got, you know, with the fire and the flame and arrows onto the boat where Kirk Douglas has been killed in battle, you know. Did all that go on? Was that kind of a ritual then, was it?
Yeah, it was, before they became Christian, there were sort of pagan rituals, and the traditional way of burying a Viking, of course, was to put them on a boat and then flame it up and then push it out to sea. Very, very romantic and things. Yeah. But the real Vikings, when they came over, they were probably Christian by the time they came across, thanks to the Irish, really, because the Irish was a very Christian country then. And we know that Christianity had a big influence on the Vikings, because they brought with them a church. And at West Kirby, there's a lovely church called St. Bridget's, and it is an old Viking church named after the Irish, or one of the two Irish patron saints. St. Bridget's, the other one's St. Patrick, of course. It's not the original church building. The original church was wooden. But inside, you can find this beautiful tombstone, this hogback tombstone, which once belonged to... once marked the gravesite of some prominent Norsemen from the old Viking community. And it's been beautifully restored by the Merseyside Conservation Centre. So if you get a chance, you could ask the rector, of course. You should go along and see this. It's really nice, yeah.
Now, I know you travelled up from Nottingham very early this morning to be here on time. And I know on your journey, you've had this in your mind all the way up here to mention Tramnir. So,
absolutely,
so away you go.
Tony's never Tony, and his producer Jimmy's never Tony, but I'd like to say congratulations to Tramnir Rovers on their fine victory last week, and I don't know whether you're tuning in, Aldo, but thanks very much, and thanks to you, Lorraine, and all the boys.
That all right, don't over-egg it now.
Fantastic
win,
yeah.
That's it. Don't over-egg the pudding, mate.
He's going to cut me off now, yes.
But Tramnir is a Viking name, isn't it?
Yes, Tramnir is an old Viking name. It means, it comes from Tranny Mel, which means crane sandbank. And by crane, we don't mean the cranes as you find in Camelert, but cranes of the bird type. So it means the sandbank with the crane birds. And Tranmere was actually one of over 600 places in the Wirral with Norwegian elements. And that shows you just how densely populated the Norwegian influence was all those years ago. Mm. Should we talk about Scouts now, Tony?
Well, tell me about Koldi, because apparently Koldi, if you translate Koldi...
Yeah.
Well, you tell me what the translation for Koldi is.
Well, I'm hoping the publication of these two books doesn't bring down the house prices of Koldi, and I apologise to residents of the area. But one translation of Koldi is cold. Can I say it? Backsides, yeah. Mm.
Cold backsides.
Cold backsides.
But that word, yeah, come on, we're all adults here. Basically, cold backside, shortened backside, and what's the slang word for backside? And you've got it, cold. Yes, exactly. Apparently, if you translate Koldi, that's what it means. Is that right?
That's right, yes. Well, that's one translation. The the other translation, it means cold islands. I think that's the translation people of Koldi prefer.
Well, when I translate Koldi, my translation actually comes out as you'll never, ever afford a house here. Me personally, but you know, that's one of those things.
My favourite place actually is a place called Hesketh's, which is in Irby. Now, Hesketh's translates, it's Hesketh's Gate, which means horse. Racetrack, and it's in Irby. Now, Irby actually means a settlement of the Irish, and it's quite interesting that you have a Viking racetrack in what we call the settlement of the Irish. Maybe that reflects the great love of the modern day Irish for races.
Yeah,
yes, isn't
of course.
That strange?
Got to be a connection in there somewhere.
Absolutely, yeah.
Well, we know you're involved in a BBC program called Blood of the Vikings, which is that coming out later this year? It's going to be out later this year.
That's right. Yes, that's right. I mean, what we're doing is that there's three programs being broadcast by the BBC Two later on this year called Blood of the Vikings. And we managed to persuade the producer to devote the majority of one programme, a third programme, to the Wirral, such as the interests in the area. And as part of the programme, what we're doing is a DNA survey of the people of the Wirral, and to see if the Wirral DNA matches the modern Nordic DNA.
So you can see there's a direct connection between the people of today and the Vikings.
Similar survey in Iceland a couple of years ago, and much to the shock, you know, everyone thinks Icelanders is as Nordic, but half of the Icelandic blood is Celtic.
So they won't like
obviously
that.
Obviously, they either brought over more slaves than they'd admit, or the Irish priests that were there beforehand were less celibate than as originally thought.
All right. Well, there's a couple of books which we must mention as well. Wirral and its Viking Heritage by, you're involved in that book as well, Stephen Harding, and Ingemann's Saga. Have I pronounced that right?
Ingemann's Saga, Norwegian
Wirral. And that's got a foreword on it by Magnus Magnusson.
Yes,
yeah, fine Magnus, Viking name.
A lovely person, yes. Mm. He had no hesitation in writing the foreword for that book.
And are these readily available, are they?
They're available now, yes. The official launch isn't until February 23rd, but having it in Birkenhead Town Hall, we've got people from the embassies of Norway, Iceland. We've got actually people from the city of Trondheim coming across from Norway, which is where we believe Ingemann came from. We've got the mayor of Trondheim coming over. And even though the official launch isn't until then, we actually sneaked out a few copies before Christmas.
See. Yeah, I understand.
And they actually sold out, believe it or not. But
we're
frantically trying to reprint them in time for the launch. In fact, I think they're available now again. So
okay. All right. Well, it's been a pleasure talking to you. Thanks for making such a long journey just to come up and do this. I appreciate it.
Pleasure, Tony.
And are you going to have a look around some of the old haunts while you're back up or what?
Absolutely, yes. Yeah absolutely.
Go over and have a cup of coffee with your mate, Aldo. Go on, then. Good to see you, Steve.
Thanks,
Thank you very
Tony.
Much indeed. It's been fascinating talking to you on Viking Wirral. Thank you.
Yeah, all the best.